Tonight, Putin welcomes his dear friend to Moscow, but will China's leader give him what he wants?
I think the day that China does decide to cross that line is the day that a new Cold War would actually start in practice rather than just in rhetoric.
The stakes are high, possibly changing the course of the war. The desperate search for loved ones.
He basically visits the hospital by hospital, but it's hopeless.
Now more questions about illegal Airbnbs.
Do they have windows? Is there a fire alarm?
And a renewed call to act.
The climate time bomb is ticking.
As scientists provide a blueprint for change, but a sign of trouble south of the border.
20 years ago, though, we would have seen water way higher here.
We'd be underwater right here, basically.
This is The National with David Kalman.
Good evening. Adrian is away. Tonight, Vladimir Putin is showing he still has one very powerful and possibly pivotal friend as he continues to wage a war against Ukraine. China's president, Xi Jinping, is in Moscow. Xi's visit bestows good optics on the Kremlin, but it's not optics the West is worried about, it's weapons. If Russia gets them from China, it could dramatically alter the course of the war. So what's happening in Moscow is being watched very closely by Kyiv, Washington, and our Breyer Stewart.
President Xi Jinping was greeted by a military band as he landed in Moscow for his fourth state visit, his first since Russia launched its full-scale invasion of Ukraine. President Putin was all smiles as the leaders met at the Kremlin before they heaped praise on each other. Dear President Putin, I always call you my dear friend, he proclaimed. Despite that overture, China is keen to portray itself as neutral when it comes to Ukraine. It positioned itself as a potential peacemaker when it rolled out a 12-point plan last month. We will discuss all these issues, including your initiative, said Putin. But some doubt China's claims of impartiality. The U.S. has repeatedly warned that China could be considering sending weapons to Russia, though they've seen no evidence it's actually happening yet. China dismisses those claims.
We continue to believe it's not in China's best interest to do that, to help Mr. Putin slaughter innocent Ukrainians. It's hard to believe that they would think that that's in their best interest.
How far, again, is it willing to go in this relationship?
Experts say sending weapons would be a big leap in what Russia and China calls its no-limits friendship, because China could be hit with sanctions and relations with the West would worsen further.
And I think that the day that China does decide to cross that line is potentially the day that a new Cold War would actually start in practice rather than just in rhetoric.
Xi's visit comes just 3 days after Putin was charged by the International Criminal Court with war crimes. But China has referred to that indictment as a double standard.
Well, it's another demonstration that China looks at the international order, at international law, as if it were a menu. We'll take this, we won't take that.
Putin and Xi met for several hours, including during a state dinner, and more meetings are scheduled for Tuesday. Ukrainian officials have urged Beijing to use its influence with Russia to try and end the war. And China does have more influence over Russia than ever before, because it's one of the few powerful allies it has. Breyer Stewart, CBC News, London.
Deputy Prime Minister Chrystia Freeland was asked about the possibility of China supporting Russia with lethal aid. Her response was firm.
China and China's leadership needs to understand the stakes here and needs to understand that Vladimir Putin is on the wrong side of history.
However, Freeland declined to lay out specific consequences if China crosses that line. Families and friends are desperately looking for any sign of their missing loved ones, many visiting Montreal in a historic building that went up in flames. Sarah Levitt now with the search for who was left inside and who was at fault.
Family and friends are demanding answers about who is responsible for a fire that ripped through a Montreal building. Montreal's mayor Valérie Plante could give little comfort.
I feel their pain, and I want to tell them that we will do the inquiry as fast as we can to find all the answers.
Crews recovered the remains of one person. Six people are still missing. Friends of neuroscientist Anne Wu fear she's among them.
We cannot find her.
Wu was in Montreal to attend a conference, booked to stay at an Airbnb in the building. Friends enlisted the help of a conference organizer to help search for her.
He basically visited hospital by hospital, trying to see if there's an Asian girl in the hospital. But it's hopeless.
Of the seven missing, six were staying in illegal Airbnbs, banned in that neighborhood.
What does the room look like? Do they have windows? Is there a fire alarm? Those are the questions families and friends are wondering.
A lawyer representing the building's owner says one tenant listed the units. A website that tracks Airbnb rentals notes more than 90% of the short-term rentals in Montreal are unlicensed. Airbnb says it's working with investigators, but the mayor says it needs to do more.
If the company doesn't force you to respect the laws of the country, of the province and of the city, then it's all mixed up.
You're talking a lot about Airbnb, but ultimately this is about the building owner, the city, building codes, the heritage aspect. Yes or no, does the city take some responsibility for this fire?
Oh, I think we do. We do is just because right now there's an inquiry and it needs to happen.
Crews continued their work today searching for victims and investigating just how this fire broke out. A lengthy and difficult job while families wait for answers. Sarah Levitt, CBC News, Montreal.
A third person has died after last week's deadly truck crash in Amqui, Quebec. 41-year-old Simon Guillaume Bourget succumbed to his injuries over the weekend and died in hospital. He was one of 11 people struck last week after a pickup truck drove into groups of pedestrians. The driver faces two counts of dangerous driving. Police, though, say they expect to lay more charges. The largest high school in Nova Scotia was a crime scene today after a stabbing incident that left three people injured and left students in shock.
Pretty hornswoggled. Definitely nothing I'd be expecting. Yeah,
exactly.
Spring break, I'd feel March like break, the first day would
first,
be better.
First period, 30 minutes into class, this happens, we look out, ton of cop cars.
Officials say two of the injured were school staff. The third was the student allegedly involved in the attack. There's no word on how serious the injuries are. That student is in custody. We turn now to what could be a remarkable moment in the United States. There are reports Donald Trump could be indicted as early as tonight. If it does happen, it would be historic and the fallout explosive. Paul Hunter with the details from Washington.
In lower Manhattan, out came the security barriers around the courthouse. Onto light poles went police cameras, all in preparation for possible protest, maybe violence, should the once unthinkable now happen. Former President Donald Trump be criminally indicted. Now expected effectively at any moment.
Hi, everyone.
It all goes back to that so-called hush money paid to adult film star Stormy Daniels just prior to the 2016 presidential election, aimed at keeping an alleged affair with Trump, something he's denied, out of the headlines. Hush money itself is not a crime. The suspected allegation is that Trump then knowingly claimed that as a legal expense and possibly broke campaign funding laws.
Can we just roll down the window for a second?
Inside the vehicle, former Trump lawyer Michael Cohen, now a key witness for prosecutors and someone who's already served prison time for his role in the payout.
Can we switch this?
Also turning out with last-minute testimony, a Trump ally who once advised Cohen, but no longer.
Listen, if they want to go after Donald Trump and they have solid evidence, so be it. But Michael Cohen is far from solid evidence.
Mr. President!
But for Trump, already running for re-election in 2024, it's one of a variety of legal challenges. Federal authorities are investigating whether he wrongly took government documents to his home in Florida after leaving office in 2021. In Georgia, a special grand jury is looking at possible election interference by Trump, with Trump lawyers now trying to quash their work. And Trump remains a focus for those investigating the rioting of January 6th. The case around Stormy Daniels is seen as the least consequential legally, perhaps a mere misdemeanor. and say some a tough one to prove, but it would make history nonetheless for being first, as Donald Trump awaits. Paul Hunter, CBC News, Washington.
U.S. President Joe Biden has signed a bill to declassify information about the origins of the COVID-19 virus. Biden says his administration will share as much information as possible while still protecting national security. There are competing theories in the U.S. about the origins of COVID. Some agencies believe it was natural transmission from animal to human. Others, though, think there may have been a leak in a Chinese laboratory. The government of French President Emmanuel Macron has survived a pair of non-confidence votes. It means the bill raising the country's retirement age from 62 to 64 now becomes law. That's how the news was greeted. More violence on the streets of Paris. The bill is deeply unpopular, fueling weeks of protests that are becoming increasingly disruptive. Macron says raising the retirement age is needed to keep the pension system from going into deficit. Trade unions are calling for another nationwide strike this Thursday. When you're waiting for a 911 operator, moments can feel like hours. But a CBC Toronto news investigation has found that Canada's largest city, well, long wait may not be that uncommon. As Angelina King explains, last year, those waits got longer.
Emergency, do you need police, ambulance, right, or fire?
That's what Brett House expected to hear when he called 911, but that didn't happen. While someone he came across on the street was having a health crisis, he was put on hold for more than 5 minutes.
5 minutes feels like an eternity.
And House wasn't alone.
Okay, rouge and wear.
That particular day, October 30th, callers waited on average nearly 6.5 minutes before someone answered.
If 911 isn't there, then it's not clear that we have any safety net.
A CBC investigation from the beginning of last year looked at wait times in 2021 and found some were as long as 10 minutes. We wanted to see whether things improved, so we filed a Freedom of Information request for 2022 wait times. Turns out, they were worse. In a six-month period, average wait times increased each month, sometimes doubling. In July, it was 5 times longer.
Seconds always count.
A national organization for public safety communicators says 911 centers across Canada are facing similar problems.
The big three issues tend to be staffing, mental health, and funding, and all three of those issues are interconnected.
Robert Stewart says Ontario should join Alberta and Quebec and implement legislation that says 911 operators answer most calls within 15 seconds or less.
What's the address?
As for funding, Ontario and Manitoba are the only provinces that currently don't charge a monthly levy on 911 services. The union representing the city's 911 staff would like it, saying, staff deserve, as does the rest of Toronto, a communication service that is appropriately funded and resourced. The Toronto Police Service, which oversees the city's 911 operation, says it's working to decrease wait times and is hiring more full-time staff, but training takes about a year. Angelina King, CBC News, Toronto.
Alberta's government has some reassuring news for parents. A fresh supply of children's pain and fever medication is being distributed to pharmacies.
And parents can feel confident that we have secured a stable supply of this medication for years to come.
Alberta ordered from a Turkish pharmaceutical company during a national shortage last year. The first shipment was delivered to hospitals in January. The province's health minister says they now have enough medication to prevent future shortages. There are concerns tonight measures to keep a U.S. bank afloat are not enough. Stocks in First Republic tanked today, sparking renewed fears that the banking crisis is not over. It comes just one day after a major bank in Switzerland was bought out, all in an effort to prevent it from going belly up. As Peter Armstrong reports, the fear is what comes next.
Markets are rattled, depositors are scared, and policymakers are rushing to reassure the world that last week's banking crisis won't spread.
I welcome the swift action and the decisions taken by the Swiss authorities. These actions are instrumental for restoring orderly market conditions and ensuring financial stability.
Global central banks banded together on Sunday to offer cash and support to keep banks calm. In a lot of ways, the immediate crisis has passed. The troubled banks have been either shut down or bought out.
UBS will remain
rock solid.
Depositors have been made whole, but last week's scare has led to a bigger concern.
The most decisive thing in banking is confidence.
Banking isn't just built on money or loans, it's built on confidence. So long as depositors believe the system works, it usually does, but that confidence has been shaken.
The confidence has been lost, and this is a damage to the whole banking system.
Each of the troubled banks had different issues, but they were all made worse by rising interest rates.
It was certainly bad risk management.
The banks bought up long-term treasuries, but as depositors fled the troubled banks, they had to sell those bonds at a loss. And that bad bet is still rippling through the entire banking system.
This is going to result in a tightening of credit conditions, as we call them, lending standards, across the world.
Canadian banks aren't nearly as vulnerable as smaller U.S. banks, and policymakers today were heralding Canada's relative stability.
A hallmark of our Canadian banks is prudent risk management, and this is also a core principle for those of us who regulate the financial system.
And Peter, clearly Canada doesn't face the same risk, but what should Canadians be worried about?
Look, we were already heading into a rough patch here. The economy's already slowed. We've been bracing for job losses. Now we have to reckon with the fact that there could be global financial instability out of this. That will exacerbate that slowdown, could exacerbate those job losses. And look, we have to face the very real possibility that this crisis is not, in fact, over and that there may be more yet to come.
Peter, always appreciate your insight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amazon is slashing 9,000 more jobs, another devastating blow to the tech sector that's been hemorrhaging workers. The layoffs will target the company's gaming service, Twitch, and its cloud computing unit. In a statement, the CEO blamed an uncertain economy. Back in January, Amazon announced 18,000 layoffs. Today's cuts come on the heels of Facebook's parent company, Meta, announcing 10,000 layoffs. Climate scientists are calling it a final warning, one last chance to limit the Earth's warming before the damage becomes irreversible. Today's UN report was 8 years in the making, and as Jayla Bernstein reports, the message is clear.
The climate time bomb is ticking.
The message was grim, with a glimmer of hope and a call to action.
Our world needs climate action on all fronts, everything, everywhere, all at once.
Today's report by the UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is the culmination of years of research from around the world. Scientists say time is running out to limit human-caused global warming to 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels.
We will probably reach 1.5 degrees in the first half of the next decade. The real question is whether our will to reduce emissions quickly means we reach 1.5 degrees. Maybe go a little bit over, but then come back down.
This is the average global temperature change since 1900. This is what the future could look like, depending on how much greenhouse gas emissions are cut. Today's report outlines what it calls a survival guide for humanity.
This report clearly emphasizes that we do have technology and know-how and tools to solve for the climate problems.
Some of those tools are already being used, including in Canada.
We've seen a revolution in batteries, both small for vehicles and large for storing power from solar and wind. There's been a huge burst of innovation across all sectors.
The UN chief wants developed nations to accelerate that innovation, calling on leaders to commit to net zero greenhouse gas emissions as close to 2040 as possible. Ottawa is studying that and says it's doing its part.
We have made a commitment that by the middle of this year, we would eliminate domestic fossil fuel subsidies.
The question remains, will it all be enough to stop that climate time bomb? Jayla Bernstein, CBC News, Montreal.
The consequences of climate change are having a potentially life-changing impact in the U.S.
Not only are the nation's eyes on us, but the world's eyes are on us.
How millions of people are being forced to adapt. And growing concern about the illegal flow of guns into Canada.
When you lost your mini-me, he was my champion.
We track how they get in and the devastating results. A citizenship ceremony years in the making.
Now I'm a Canadian citizen. This flag means everything to me.
We're back in two. Today's climate change report warned of disastrous consequences if countries do little to stem their use of fossil fuels. Those consequences are already playing out in parts of the U.S. Americans facing a critical water shortage after decades of drought. The country's largest reservoir is now at dangerously low levels. Located about 40 kilometers east of Las Vegas, Lake Mead is on the Colorado River and runs along the Nevada-Arizona border. The CBC's international climate correspondent, Susan Ormiston, went to see the drying reservoir firsthand.
Consider Bruce Nelson's predicament, running a boating business on America's largest freshwater reservoir. Big, stunning, and shrinking. The white markings, so-called bathtub rings, reveal how much Lake Mead has dropped, over 50 meters.
You know, we have a telltale sign because of hard water deposits, but if we didn't have that and that was all brown, nobody would have an idea that this lake was low.
But it is, hovering near record lows, the Hoover Dam allowing less water downstream, an alarming sign of a stubborn drought threatening water supply to tens of millions of Americans.
Drought with climate change being what it seems to be, you get people scared and we have to change. We live in the desert. We have to make sure that we are being water cautious.
The flow from the Colorado River is dramatically reduced, forcing a hard recalculation of who gets how much water when there's less. The seven states which depend on this water must agree to large cuts to consumption this spring, or the U.S. government will impose them.
2000 to 2022 is the driest 23-year period on record for the Colorado River.
Colby Pellegrino works for the Southern Nevada Water Authority.
We don't know what the future holds in terms of climate change. There's a very good chance that what we're experiencing today, and considering historic drought, could be the historic wet period of the next 100 years, which is quite scary. So I think not only are the nation's eyes on us, but the world's eyes are on us.
There's no ignoring the signs. Once sunken boats, beached, even exposed human remains, this old marina had to relocate here as the water levels dropped. The national park's ramp to the boat launch, it's like a runway now.
So 20 years ago, though, we would have seen water way higher here.
We'd be underwater right here, basically.
Park Superintendent Mike Gauthier has to keep adapting services, knowing the reservoir could drop further.
And think of it as a cocktail glass, so to speak. You've got canyons and the rivers at the bottom. So as it fills, the glass gets full, and you have more water at the top. But as it goes down, it declines a little faster.
The looming fear is Lake Mead could reach what's called Deadpool. So low, water can't flow over the dam.
There's a lot of smart minds working hard to solve this problem, and there's a lot of hope. It's just going to take some changes, and change is hard for people.
Lake Mead is a barometer of the difficult decisions ahead.
Susan, parts of the Southwest were recently hit with those massive storms, snow, and heavy rains. How will that impact the water supply?
Well, they'll take it gladly, hoping that that deeper snowpack will translate into more runoff into the river system and not get sucked up by this arid ground. But experts say it would take years of winters like this one just to begin to replenish what's been lost. I mean, this reservoir is like a bank account, and the mega drought robbed it, and consumers are kind of depleting the rest. It's a cautionary tale for all of us. And if, as the UN climate report said today, these droughts get longer and more severe, conservation measures may not be enough. And that's why they're starting here in the Southwest. They will be taking deep cuts to the water supply this year, David.
Susan Ormiston in Lake Mead, Nevada. Thank you.
You're welcome.
A massive health hazard in India continues to grow despite the risks.
Just jump over.
Yeah, jump over. You can see that.
He's going right now.
Yeah, yeah.
Why so many people rely on this landfill. But first, from Texas to Ottawa, the shocking rate at which guns are making their way north.
Very hard to shoot incorrectly because it does all the work for you.
The National takes you deeper into the story shaping your world. Next. As Ottawa looks to strengthen gun control, American firearms continue to flow through the border, ending up on Canadian streets and used to harm citizens. In Ontario, 90% of guns used in a criminal act that are traced tie back to the U.S. Jorge Barrera takes you inside the illicit gun trade and tracks just how easily legal guns in the U.S. can end up in Canada.
Have you ever shot a red dog?
No, I haven't.
That shit changes the game. It's cheating.
Way more accurate.
It's easy to buy a gun in this part of Texas.
Put it in, just do-do-do. It does the job.
Boom.
Yep.
Like baseball cards, guns are bought, sold, traded here through a largely unregulated one-to-one private market.
It has 3 21 rounders, so you get 63 shots total.
63, okay.
With 9mm.
It's one of the sources feeding the many American streams flooding Canada's streets with illegal handguns, leaving death in their wake. Like in Ottawa, where guns killed nearly 40 people since 2017. During that same time span, police in the city seized over 352 handguns, the majority smuggled from the U.S., and bullets keep cutting down the young and the innocent. Including Tyson Dengozi.
In the morning when I come, I already saw some blood down.
Joris Dengozi says he doesn't often visit the spot where his son's life bled into the pavement.
One guy go and bingo shoot and he shoot him. Yeah.
Just 20 years old, big dreams full of promise, shot and killed on a Sunday in 2021. He was playing basketball one evening with a friend, the wrong place, the wrong time.
When you lost your mini-me, he was my champion.
RCMP Corporal Angelique Dignard's job on a border task force is to disrupt the flow of smuggled guns.
This is the general area where I got the radio transmission, where I got the call.
In 2020, Canadian border surveillance spotted a boat crossing the St. Lawrence River. The boat stopped here, a man jumped to shore, and Corporal Dignard began the hunt.
He was carrying a checkered bag, and he got into a vehicle. It was an SUV, so I left on patrol and I headed in this direction looking for a vehicle that matched the description. But I didn't identify it as the vehicle that I was looking for until I stopped right behind them at the light.
The RCMP found 9 guns in the SUV and arrested 4 men, all from Ottawa, but only one was convicted for gun smuggling. Tony and Zoigba, the man with the bag.
The good thing right now is those guns that were in your bag last night will never hit the streets. None of those guns are going to kill people.
Corporal Dignard questioned Zoigba for nearly 2 hours. He wouldn't give anything away.
Did you traffic guns from out of the country into this country?
Like I stated before, I shall not be answering this.
Ngzoiba, 24 years old, never revealed where and how he got these 9 guns destined for city streets in Ontario. A CBC News investigation found these pistols all came from the suburbs around Houston. We traveled to Texas to see how easy it is for anyone to get a gun here. You don't need underworld connections, just the internet, a cell phone, and cash. I'm here on this website right now going through listings put up by individuals, you know, looking to offload their own personal guns. So I'm gonna try to get in touch with some of these people selling guns. I don't want them to know I'm a journalist. So I'm going to go buy a burner phone and start reaching out to these people.
There you go. Thank you so much. Bye.
Hey, brother.
You wanna do it over there?
Yeah.
Very hard to shoot incorrectly because it does all the work for you.
Okay.
It has the compensator here.
Shit. I've never actually seen a gun like this.
We talk for less than 10 minutes. He offers me a deal. No questions asked. No ID required.
So you want 15?
I listed it for 17.
17.
10 trade. Okay. But if you take it, I'll do 16, 1650.
I say I'll get back to him.
All right. By 3 o'clock tomorrow. Okay. Is that a good deadline?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Within 6 hours of buying the burner phone, I could have bought a gun.
In our investigation, we found that one of the guns in Tony Nzoigba's bag was once legally owned by James Minshew, a law enforcement officer with Brazoria County in Texas.
Hello, Deputy Sheriff Minshew?
Yes, sir.
Hi, how are you, sir? My name is Jorge Barrera. I'm a reporter calling you from Canada.
We called him from Ottawa, but he didn't want to talk. So we went to his home to ask him how he felt about his gun getting smuggled into Canada.
Once I gave it to a person that I can in full faith believe is a reputable person, what they do with it after that, I don't know. Like, I have only sold firearms to licensed dealers or people that I know are peace officers, which are cops in Texas.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I don't know how any of that happens.
Okay.
It's important to know that the gun was perfectly legal until after Minshew sold it in March 2020. In a little over a month, it entered criminal hands
through an illegal gun dealer using the private market named Craig Cornelison from suburban Houston. He's now serving 18 months in federal prison for selling guns without a license. Court records say Cornelison sold hundreds of guns at gun shows like these under the cover of private sales. Wads of cash for guns by the tub, including these 9 guns found in Nzoigba's duffel bag and in this video labeled Houston, pulled from Nzoigba's phone.
Look, in these times, the bottom line for anybody is money.
Nzoigba now serving an 18-month sentence in Canadian prison. American guns keep coming. The latest stats show in Ontario alone, 90% of trace crime-related handguns come from the U.S., most from Texas. The deaths also keep coming. And Tony Nzoigba's hometown of Ottawa, well, it's killed 2 people in February.
All families die because of one person.
Some never find justice. Ottawa police couldn't catch Tyson's killer. His father left with only memories of his mini-me.
God forgive him, because he don't know what he do. He don't know how many families he make trouble. He killed children, he killed also my children. Because when you kill, for example, my son, when you kill Tyson, you stop many things. It's difficult. But what the last things I can say, let God forgive him, because he don't know what he do.
Jorge, this is also remarkable. You trace these guns back to the original owners. Can police do the same thing?
Well, we've all seen that part in the movie where the bad guy files off the serial number from the stolen gun. Well, filing or removing the serial number from a gun no longer blocks a police investigation. With new technology, police can recover that serial number within the hour. And that's important information because it allows investigators on both sides of the border to start figuring out how that gun got on the street. New technology can also link a shell casing recovered from a crime scene with a specific gun quicker than ever, meaning a gun seized at a traffic stop can be connected to a murder within days. Now, law enforcement sources say that the federal government just isn't pushing or providing enough dollars to Canadian police forces to widely adopt these technologies, and it's hampering efforts to stem the flow of illegal guns across the border. David?
Amazing. Jorge, thank you. Next, it's a source of concern and of livelihood.
The plastic waste and without any gloves, without any masks.
Why calls to eliminate a massive mountain of waste have gone unanswered for years? On a day when climate scientists are raising the alarm about a planet in peril, in Mumbai, thousands of people are doing what they do every day, eking out a meager existence on a literal mountain of garbage. Toxic fumes make the search for scraps of plastic and metal dangerous. even deadly. But as Salima Shivji shows us, they have no choice.
It's massive and imposing. A sprawling mountain in East Mumbai, some 18 stories high. Made up entirely of waste, 16 million tons of it. In the hundreds of narrow alleys that wind around the mountain, the trash seeps into life. Piles of plastic everywhere you look. It's literally a way of life for the pickers who spend hours on end rummaging, finding any bits of plastic or metal that they can sell. Dangerous work full of health risks, but essential for so many here.
So it's this way?
Yeah, this way.
Local doctor Rajesh Prajapati guides me through one of the many paths that lead directly to the garbage mountain.
From all over Mumbai, waste has come in this dumping ground.
It may be walled off, but there are many ways to get in.
They just jump over.
Yeah, jump over. You can see that.
He's going right now?
Yeah, yeah.
He's coming. Means,
yeah, see.
Darting in and out of tunnels like this one. The work is painstaking. Wading through the muck of the mountain for possible treasures is one thing. Sorting it and then hawking it, quite another. Jehana Sheikh does it every day, worrying every single minute, as she struggles to feed her family with a husband who beats her at home. Her 12-year-old son split his head open after a fall while trying to sell a bag full of salvaged plastics. She's lost 3 of her 6 children to sudden illness, the eldest to tuberculosis, she says, because of the filth they sort and breathe. Still, they do it. If we don't go to the landfill to pick through waste for one day, we starve that day, Jehana says. We barely make enough to get by, leaving her family little choice. That's the harsh reality for those living so close to a massive garbage deposit.
The plastic waste and without any gloves, without any masks, what to do?
In his 5 years assigned to this area, Dr. Prajapati has seen far too many medical cases that disturb him, attributed to the fumes emanating from the rotting waste.
And does the water also bring the more fumes out?
Yeah, fumes. We can not also breathe properly. Because of these fumes, like ammonia and carbon dioxide, and some kind of like rotten eggs, you know?
Rotten. Yeah, everything's decomposing.
Decomposed.
And releasing noxious fumes, poisoning the air.
Everywhere you go in this neighborhood, hugging the edge of a giant mountain of waste, you're accosted by the smell of decomposing garbage. In this case, right here, it smells like toxic ammonia.
It wafts in every corner and has major health effects on the neighborhoods bordering the landfill that's been entrenched for nearly a century. Rates of tuberculosis and other diseases are far higher here, experts say, made worse by cramped housing. Aisha Rahim Sheikh knows the dangers. She tries to keep busy. But she's mourning her younger sister, Shafiq, who died at 18 days after this photo was taken. I miss her so much, Sheikh says. She had TB. Her breath would quicken and she'd get feverish, but we never thought she would die, leaving the family broken. It's a complicated struggle for those living here, where an entire ecosystem thrives despite the health hazards, with some 100,000 livelihoods directly linked to the massive landfill. Successive governments have tried to tackle India's waste mountains. This one in Mumbai, the Onar, is the subject of a court case to try to close it down, a case that's dragged on for 27 years. In late 2021, India's prime minister again promised that the mounds of garbage in cities will be eliminated completely and fast, replaced with sewage treatment plants. A lofty goal, but some experts are skeptical.
We have a dumping ground here in Devnar, which has been initiated in the 1940s. The orders for closure of the Devnar dumping ground have been given more than 10 years ago, and there is still no success in attempting a closure.
And so the scavenging goes on in the shadow of the mountain.
Show me.
Jehana's home is mere steps away, and she and her children go back and forth regularly. She tries her best not to think of the toll the grueling work takes. But she can't hold back the tears some days. She has no help from an abusive husband and so many mouths to feed. Picking through grime and filth, a brutal necessity for so many here, struggling to keep going. Salima Shivji, CBC News, Mumbai.
The Deonar dump is the largest in India, but a recent study found that there are more than 3,000 other garbage mountains across the country. A clarification on a story we brought you last month, which contained a disturbing image. We talked to migrants at the U.S.-Mexico border hoping to come to Canada. One couple showed us the video they said they recorded recently of a crocodile swimming with a human leg. That video appears to have been recorded several years ago. A Harlem Globetrotter teaches Canadian kids his trick to success.
I learned that basketball is not only just about playing, it's about having a good mindset.
His advice, both on and off the court, in our moment. Two new Canadians are thankful for their citizenship papers this month. That's because their journey to Canada was a treacherous one across a dangerous border in frigid temperatures that nearly killed them. It was a story that drew international attention. Cameron McIntosh now on their new life.
That's how it looks like.
Wrapped in the flag in celebration. 6 years ago, Razak El and Saidu Muhammad nearly froze to death just trying to get into Canada. Now they're citizens.
Now I'm a Canadian citizen. This flag means everything to me.
We are very grateful and very thankful to God that like we are still alive here and we have been accepted in this country that we now call our home.
On Christmas Eve 2016, Muhammad and El, both from Ghana, crossed the border near Emerson, Manitoba to seek asylum.
We saw a light, like the border between the US and Canada.
Conditions were so cold, both men were severely injured. Their fingers needed to be amputated.
We struggled on it like three hours. We were still walking in the snow. We didn't know we were gonna make it. We thought we were going to die there.
As they recovered, they successfully filed refugee claims. Muhammad over his sexual orientation, Yale to escape political persecution. Over the last 6 years, they've worked and volunteered with the help of the Ghanaian community and a Christian aid agency.
That's how Canadians do. They always help each other. No matter what, if you need some help, someone is up there to help you.
Both men are now in school. Yale is hoping to bring his wife to Canada this year. Muhammad, a former professional soccer player, has dreams of starting a business.
Being a Canadian means everything to me. And Canada is not just my home, it's part of who I am.
The end of one journey and the beginning of another. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Winnipeg.
It was lunch hour at a high school in Quebec, but the gym was full of activity as these high school students got a chance to take the court with a professional basketball player. A visit from a Harlem Globetrotter left these students with a few new tricks up their sleeve and some valuable life lessons. Basketball paired with advice is tonight's moment.
My confidence that, like, even though I might think I'm the shortest guy, if I could score on one of the Globetrotters, I could do some, you know?
It's my favorite thing about being a Globetrotter, to be able to speak to the kids, because I was a kid who was so shy and didn't want to participate in anything because I was afraid of how people looked at me. I was afraid of how people might judge me.
Anything that you feel discomfort with, but you know that there's something good on the other side of it, you got to take that leap of faith.
So to have somebody come in and be able to set the example and be proof of what happens when you step outside of your comfort zone, that's where the growth is at.
I learned many life lessons he taught me. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon.
I learned the thing where you put it behind your back, behind your legs. I learned that basketball is not only just about playing, it's about having a good mindset, like you say, positive.
It makes me feel great. It makes me believe in myself more, you know what I mean?
Well, that is really nice to see and some pretty amazing tricks. I'm sure lunch was very, very busy, but entirely inside the gym. Kind of amazing about the Globetrotters. They've been around 97 years now. quite something. That is The National for this March 20th. Thanks so much for being with us. Have a great night.